ఆశ్చర్య అస్టానిషింగ్ అమేజింగ్. ఇట్స్ అన్ అస్టానిషింగ్ థింగ్ దట్ సచ్ అ మెటీరియలిస్టిక్ పర్సన్ లైక్ పీటర్ ఆస్ట్ర could achieve a yogic perfection. Yogic perfection is usually something one gets after a lifelong practice of yoga. But he achieved it after a very short time. And after many times during his life when the Pandavas' interest was brought up that what he was doing wasn't proper, he would kind of shrug his shoulders and say, well, what can I do? I'm attached to my children. And that was like enough reason to kill his nephews. Do so many simple things. So that's why quite materialistic. Very attached to kin and what we call kin and keep. Kin and keep. The family and relatives. But he was finally able to achieve that state of mystic perfection, of yogic perfection. So that was quite something quite astonishing. So it shows how even a little time, little association from a great soul like Vidura could change the destiny of someone like Dhritarashtra. Normally he was inherited to some hellish destination. Because of his yoga practice, he could achieve a liberated state. It says Vidura was feeling delight and grief. So his success, the source of delight, two reasons for grief, Prabhupada cited. One is that he couldn't make him a devotee. If you get back to Krishna, then sansari paramam gata rahmavanti mahatma you don't go from back again if you achieve the highest destination of Krishna's lotus feet, but that's only achievable by bhakti. There are some other kinds of liberation, but one can again fall down from the impersonal liberation. It's not a permanent situation. So, that's one source of grief, what to do. He couldn't make him a devotee because he committed so many Vaishnava apradhas against the Pandavas. Prabhupada stresses the point that a Vaishnava apradha is more dangerous than a Krishna apradha. Krishna can forgive someone for Vaishnava apradha only if the Vaishnava forgives. But if Krishna apradha, he can directly forgive. So therefore, it is more complicated to offend the Vaishnava. 10 offenses, the holy name, the first offense is the Vaishnava apradha. What Chaitanya also stated, Vaishnava apradha matal hati upare vachin de thar suki chai pata. that the offense to the Vaishnavas is like pulling out the roots of the tree, like a mad elephant pulling out a tree right by from the root up and throwing it and trampling on it. Then the tree, the branches and leaves will be green for a little while. Within branches they'll dry and the leaves will fall off and it's dead. So our devotional fever can get completely finished by Vaishnava Purana. Since Dhritarashtra has done so much Vaishnava Purana, Bhakti loads of beasts not going to grow much in his garden. Somehow by Vidura's preaching got him to do mystic yoga. And he was successful. So that was quite amazing, Acharya. Other reason Prabhupada gave is just that by although Dhritarashtra, he was having this material streak, he also was very illustrious family and he had some good qualities also. He had his weakness and he had his some good qualities. So somehow Vidura, in his separation, he was grief-stricken. So visiting the holy places, pilgrimage means going and visiting holy places. So that gives some relief. You go to a holy place and you can hear the glories of the holy place. Jai Naramadavas Ashtasati Ki. Jai Lalita Champagalota Chintudevi Tunga Vidya Visakhi Indule Karangani Visunevi Ki. Naramadava Ki. Naramadava Mayapur Chandra Ki. Giridhani Ki. Giriraj Ki. In the Padma Purana it mentions about holy places. There's one meaning of holy places in terms of how much sin they can neutralize. So there's all grades of holy places in India. In some holy places, by taking a bath there, by going there, you can get rid of one kind of sin. But if you want to, if you've done a bigger sin than that, then it won't wash it away. You have to go to a higher grade of holy place. So like that, so there are stories, there are histories where sometimes someone committed a lot of karma. Sometimes the avatar is just to show the glorified some holy place, Parshuram, after killing so many 21 generations of Kshatriyas. Purana is saying that his chopper was stuck to his hand, wouldn't come off. Then he would try to bathe in holy places and go somewhere, but nothing would free the chopper from his hand. There was one place in Assam, some sacred Kunda. And he made there, and then there the chopper got released. So now all the people go there once a year through the jungle by the Arunachal border, and they go bathing in this Parshuram Kunda. Like that, there are seven places where if you leave your body, you go back to Godhead. One of those places is Mayapur. So the Prabhupada, when he came here, he said, living and dying in Mayapur is all the same. You're living here in the spiritual world, and when you die, you go back to the spiritual world. So, this is a Gupta Kirtan. Because when the Vedas were written 5,000 years ago, Lord Chaitanya had not appeared and he was coming as a Bhakta avatar. So they gave it too directly about his coming, then it would no longer be a, he couldn't come as a devotee. So in some ways it was mentioned, but not so easy to find out. After he's come, it's easy to figure out, okay, Krishna Varnam Trisa Krishnam Sankapanga Saparishadam Lengai Sankirtana Prayajanti Sumedasa. Okay, this verse is describing Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. You can, everything matches up. Like that, there are so many verses, but beforehand, it wasn't so clear. Who was that referring to? Doesn't directly give the name so clearly. So like that. Nityananda Prabhu says, in all the holy places, in Kali Yuga, they get their strength actually diminished. But Namadev Dham's strength increases. So the capacity to neutralize people's sinful activities and purify them and awaken their devotion is increasing. More people that come here and do the Harinam Yajna, the Gorpurnima festival, more enthusiasm they're getting for Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's service. That's a special mercy of this Navadvip Dham. There are so many holy places in India, still just the beginning of Kali Yuga. So some still have a little Shakti left. Not totally overloaded here. But even green souls, like Vidura, they visit the holy places, and by their going to the holy places, they also purify them. And all around Lord Chaitanya and Nityananda, they visited so many holy places and gave their lotus foot dust there. Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur established a lotus footprints of Lord Chaitanya in a number of places around India. So in Kanainashala there's a lotus footprint. Then in mainly they put in South India. But I think in Gaya also we saw a lotus footprint of Lord Chaitanya somewhere. Not sure. I thought we saw. But if we didn't, we should make a study where the lotus footprints were put. When they're not put, we can put. Like in Tirupati, there's lotus footprint. But it's quite neglected sometimes. Then in Srirangam, there's lotus footprints. Aholam we put. Iskan Safari put in the Ovalam. We also put in Trivandrum, Tiruvananthapuram, at the Padmanabha temple. But I read also that Balaram visited that temple. We can start. Where else are the lotus footprints of Lord Chaitanya? So Mangalgiri there is halfway up. Chaganapuri? Where? We're in the Chaganapuri temple. That we're not all having the same access to. But But Lord Chaitanya, pastimes are all over Jagannath Puri, Gombira, and Siddha Gokul. You can put some lotus footprints in those places too. Haridas Thakur, Samadhi. Chakra Chaita, so many places. Gundicha, Narsingha Mandir, Indra Dumna Kunda, Narendra Sarovar. How many pastime places are there where Lord Chaitanya participated? Lord Chaitanya visited Udupi, but I don't think there's lotus footprints there. So, like that. That's the one way of. Can I Darshala? There's a lotus footprint. But not in Ram Keli. Ram Keli, you saw? Oh yeah, there are.
Yeah.
Footprints are where we initiated Rupin Sanati. Little house with the tamal trees. So, Lord Chaitanya, he made the holy places more holy by blessing them by his presence, Lord Nityananda. So this is a special kind of tourism in India, pilgrimage tourism. Now in the world they have ecotourism, cultural tourism, sports tourism, adventure tourism. But they found that one of the important tourisms is also pilgrimage tourism. So somehow, this is a way for the government. The government is supposed to be secular in these modern democracies, so they're not supposed to favor any religion, but if it's good for the economy, then it's all right. So, by giving it a name like pilgrimage tourism, okay, then it's okay, we can now develop the holy places. Someone told me that for some historical people, central government is giving 20 crores of rupees in some places. We were discussing how Prabhupada's birthplace, that should become also then very special touristic place. Prabhupada was born in Calcutta. He started a worldwide Bhakti movement, Hare Krishna movement. So, Mahamasya's birthplace should be developed for people to recognize his great personality. Bhakti is something that needs to be popularized. In the world, there's a lot of. But before, there was no one knew about reincarnation. I mean, when I grew up, I never knew about reincarnation. I only heard about it when I was in college. It was something that wasn't talked about in my high school. But nowadays, so many people know it's a common discussion topic, karma, reincarnation, yoga. So many people are doing yoga. Even in Muslim countries, it's okay to do yoga for health. But then, so that gradually because of yoga that some people are being brought a little closer to Vedic culture or bhakti. The idea is that bhakti, however, is a direct process. It's very like Sridharashtra, he achieved perfection by yoga. But he's not guaranteed to go back to Godhead. He goes to the jyoti, to the Brahma jyoti, again he has to come back. The bhakti process is much more rapid, quick, it takes you to the highest destination. But somehow still bhakti is very confidential. Not so many people know about bhakti. we still have other work to do to popularize bhakti. One of the things that people, when they come to India, also to facilitate them to go on pilgrimage, to visit holy places. 20 years ago when I went to Varanasi, when we were 30 years, 1971, how many years is that? 4 years ago. I was with Srila Prabhupada when he went to Kumbh Mela in Allahabad, then he also went to Varanasi. I had forgotten, but some devotee was there initiated in Varanasi, said, "You were there at my initiation." I remember, no, I didn't know why here. I remember I was there before with Prabhupada. I didn't remember why here. So I was 71. In those days, I didn't have Ganga Puja. 5 years ago, they started Ganga Puja in Varanasi. You know, thousands of people gathered to watch the evening Ganga Puja. They do it all year long. Every day, 5 pujaris and a Deepavali, 21 pujaris and 42 kumaris with fans. Once a year for Deepavali. We are reading in the Ganga book, quotes from the Purana, from the Purana, others. How in different ages, different things are good for spiritual development. I don't remember each age what each story. Like, there's a verse in the Bhagavatam that says, Kiti Daito Vishnu Yachitai Madhvara Chaitiyam Yachitamakai. That in Sati Yoga you should meditate as the Yajna. And Chaitanya Yoga is sacrifice. Dwarpa Yoga is temple worship. In Kali Yoga is chanting the holy names. So there was another 4 category, like what kind of dharma is purifying something, I forget. So then again, for each yuga, what was the recommended? But then it said, for Kali Yuga, bathing in the Ganges. What was the tapa you have to do? The tapa. It said, for people in Kali Yuga, they go bathe in the Ganges, that's their tapa, something like that. It was mentioned, like in different yugas, there were different things, fasting and meditating and whatever. But then, in Kali Yuga, just bathing in the Ganga, that's austerity. Then there's 108 verses in the Skanda Purana glorifying the Ganga. How by bathing in the Ganges, one gets purified from so many karmas, how bathing in the Yuga awakens their devotion. How it goes on and on, quite blissful. We read about 30 in the Ganga Sahara, we didn't finish the 108. We are reading in the Pancha Ganga, God, the Lord Chaitanya bathed in Varanasi. The 5 different rivers are meeting there. So we know Lord Chaitanya bathed there, we often say, we'll bathe in that God. We are reading so many wonderful verses about the Ganga. But I was remembering in Chaitanya Bhagavat, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, the Ganga is liquid Krishna paint. But see, the most relevant, I mean, that's the most, the greatest glorification I ever heard. Liquid Krishna paint. Can you imagine bathing in liquid Krishna paint? Liquid love of Godhead. Little potion, little bottle. So, here we are, the holy name. We were in the Ganga Sahara. The holy name is the most, is the Yajna for the Yuga. The bathing in the Ganges is some of the other, this process, the tapa for the Yuga, something like that, tapa or something like that. And then, and of course, it also says that the holy place of the yuga is Mayapur Dham. So we're ready, and we're also in the Bhagirathi. So I was telling all the sadhus along the Ganges who are worshipping Ganga that we're also on the Ganges. There's something in common. When we went to Devaprayag, there's a Ram temple, and they said that Ram and Lakshman, after killing Ravan, the Ravan was technically Brahmin, so it was Brahmahatya, so he's playing the Leela of a Kshatriya, how to get freed from his Brahmahatya, so he made in Devaprayag, where the Alakananda and the Bhagirathi are coming together, and there becomes the Ganga. So this is one of the five prayags. Prayag in Chittaraj, Prayag in Allahabad, the Deva Prayag, where the number is three more prayags. Deva Prayag, second most important. From that point, she's known as Ganga, we were told. So, but here we are, we find that Lord Chaitanya on the day of Gaur Purnima, the Ganges was coming down and Bhagirathi, Bhagi Maharaj was bringing her. And then here at Mayapur, Ganga stopped. So you can't figure out why she's not moving, she just stopped. So then he's praying and meditating to find out why she's not moving. And she communicates that very soon will be Gaur Purnima. The Lord Chaitanya appears on the Gaur Purnima, the Phalgun Purnima. So on that day, love is flowing. So I want to be in Mayapur on that day. Then I'll go, after that I'll go. That's why it says on the Gaur Purnima day, this is the place called Ganga Nagara, the area. More or less our area near the area opposite from nearby the Berkeley, this whole area, Ganga Nagar. Whoever bathes on the Gaur Purnima day, that time Krishna Prem is kept there. You get love of Krishna very easily. We're in such an important place. So make Mayapur more oriented also that to attract the foreign tourists here. Atmananda Prabhu told me, who's the one who teaches Atma Yoga, would he like to do a retreat here to teach his Atma Yoga maybe in the month of Damodar to have international students. We go all, we went this year all over India and Michigan Harbor, saw so many foreigners. One of them came here, as I mentioned, in the Vyas Puja. I don't know if he's still here. But so many are there, they don't know anything about Bhakti Yoga. They're wearing Rudraksha, they're doing all kinds of weird things that they don't know about. Those places are not too much Bhakti oriented. Of course, our ISKCON temples there could do more. We can attract people to Vrindavan and to Mayapur and to other holy places where we have ISKCON temples, Tirupati. It's a good scope for training up the foreigners in Bhakti Yoga. Vidura is visiting all the holy places, so some value is there in the holy places, and this is the most holy place in Kali Yuga. Most purifying. Of course, our devotees come here and they get all the benefit. They go back around the world and they're preaching, getting some shakti from Mayapur Dham. What about all the other people who are not yet devotees? They could come here. Someone's mentioning that they see some of the Christian priests and some of the sannyasis from other missions are coming now and spending the night. apparently the news is out something about Mayapur, so they're coming and taking it up. But only very few foreign tourists come so far. Prabhupada wanted this also to be a worldwide tourist attraction. The people will come here but get the bhakti. So this one devotee, that new devotee came and asked and said, okay, what should I do now? I was thinking, where do we have a bhakti program for foreign tourists? Everything is geared for the devotees or for Indians. Do you have a program for foreign tourists? Sure, that's what I'm saying. Is it something to have? Because that's what this, we saw so many ashrams have in all these places like Rishikesh. They got a bhakti program for foreign tourists. But it's not a bhakti program, it's like a Mayavadi program. Training program, how to become a good Mayavadi yogi. That type of program. We will call bhakti, but it's not bhakti. It's not bhakti program, it's training program. They all wear pajamas and put on rudrakshas and they sit and watch Ganga Puja and they perform Durga Yajnas and what, all that type of thing. So they're not getting the advantage of, because in all these holy places, like we heard in Varanasi, it's as holy because there is the presiding deity of this place of Shiva, but also there's the deity there of Bindu Madhava. And he also is presiding deity. Now first the Vishnu sanctified the place and then Shiva went there because he's the devotee of Vishnu. So anyone who leaves their body in Varanasi, Shiva goes and chants Ram Nam in their ear. Because they hear the name of Ram, they go back to Gandhi. We know that near Bhojumdi, by Harihar Ketra, which is not different from Varanasi, if anyone leaves their body there, what is Lord Shiva chanting in his ear? Straight back to the boat. We have all the holy places in Bhavadeep down. So, I think one's word that we needed, of course, to have a training program, a bhakti program for foreigners, is we need a few foreign devotees to take this up. That's why there's so few of you are here. Because initially, our Indian devotees are a little bit shy, they don't know exactly how to deal with the foreigners. But we put some Indians with foreigners and then together they can get trained up. Once they'll get trained up, then they can do it. We have to get Goa and Haridwar and the Varanasi and the tourists, and some are going to get Mayapur and then come over here and have some programs for them. So Vidura, to get some relief, he went to the holy place. So people to get some peace of mind when they go to these holy places. They can feel some different vibration. And then so many people come in to me when they come to Mayapur, then they feel so much. So the first coming out, sometimes it's all villages and the roads, sometimes lousy. They wonder, where are they taking me? Once they come to the gate, they say, oh, this is such a nice place. And they can feel the difference. So we want Mayapur to govern them. So for that we need help, we need so much help, so many things to be done. To develop special training courses. Mantra yoga, bhakti yoga, natural path, come here for healing and get spiritually healed also. just like Avadhikas, just like Vidura, he preached to Dhritarashtra, who was not the bhakta oriented. So he gave some other process, but he got him liberated. So some people may come here without initially being bhaktas. They brought a group from Taiwan, yoga group, and they had I welcomed them all and gave them pictures and souvenirs. Then they said, you know, when we were studying yoga in Taiwan, we don't know so much about bhakti. They told us, come to the holy place in India. For us, this is we thought everyone sits in Mangal Arati, and you all sit and do, you know, yoga asanas or something. They didn't have so much introduction to bhakti. But now they came to Mayapur and it was like a crash course. So they all got their beads and were chanting. And so the Taiwanese yogis and yoginis became, many of them became bhakta. But they said for us, this is a big culture shock. We didn't know what to expect. They didn't warn them. They just said, come for the pilgrimage. So they had many questions about the deities, about the process of bhakti. So like that, some of our places are teaching this in yoga now in Australia and Sydney. They started two yoga centers, one in downtown and one in the country. Because there's something like 40 million people in the world are doing yoga now. But hardly any of them know about bhakti yoga. So now a lot of the devotees are trying to tap into this network and then introduce bhakti to the yoga network. So those yogis are coming to India for pilgrimage is one of the things that they do. With the Halvidura, he used the yoga to liberate his brother. Dwapara Yuga level. But we can use yoga to bring them to bhakti. We can use different pilgrimages visiting India to bring them to bhakti, to bring them to Krishna. If the Dura could do it for his materialistic brother, why can't Prat? We see the whole world as our brothers and sisters. We can do it for the world. Those people do that kind of preaching, they have to be very well grounded in bhakti so they don't get influenced. But they can rather use the process to bring the people closer. Like Prabhupada said, some of the modern music is not meant for the devotees, it's meant for the public to bring them closer. He allowed it. But he said it's not meant like you play it in the temple, it's meant for the public. So there are some places and some times where we can use different processes to bring people. So this particular verse, Vidura, he used the yoga system that was to liberate his brother. Krishna, you're not the body. Why are you so attached to all this bodily comfort? You're being insulted by your nephew who started giving some heavy preaching. You do mystic yoga, you do meditation. And so he got Vidurasa into it and he did it. He was successful. So if he can do it for his materialistic brother, we can do it for materialistic brothers and sisters. Some may directly accept the bhakti system, some may require a little bit of orientation. We can offend their ligaments a little bit first or something. There's a lot of people out there looking to India for spiritual direction, but the people who are leading the propaganda in the spiritual front are not bhakti yogis. I'm the vice president of the World Hindu Federation. And most of all the members of World Hindu Federation, I practically was the first one that was a Vaishnava. But now they have become here, we have one meeting here, they appreciate it so much. They don't know also. They don't know about they saw the temple, they were here, they appreciate it so much. Now also that most of the people in the World Federation are we have Hindu Sangam and Malaysia were worshipping Shiva, but now they've accepted that Bhagavad Gita, Vishnu worship is okay. How can they deny as part of Hinduism? But for many people, it was in their dictionary. So reaching out and making links and bringing people closer, connecting them. When we go, because for us, we also respect Shiva, but we see Shiva as a Param Vaishnava. But others are thinking that Shiva, Brahma, Vishnu, they're all the same, it's different aspects of God, and ultimately God is impersonal. They have all these misconceptions. So we have to be very well grounded in our own Vaishnava philosophy and then gradually promote what is the real way of seeing things. Because people, they are trained from their childhood in some other ways of seeing things. Not any places like Tirupati where Vishnu is on the top of the hill and he is the supreme. Some places someone else is on top of the hill. So how to... When I was going in Sri Lanka and I was preaching there from Bhagavatam, and then the Shivites, they were telling me, why you don't preach to us from Shiva Puran and Skanda Puran? Why only Bhagavad Puran? So I did a scan of the folio and I found all the quotes in the folio from Skanda Puran and Shiva Puran. And there's so many wonderful quotes. So one quote was there, I like to quote it to them. Skanda Puran, it says, you should chant these two syllables. Ha!
Ha!
By chanting these two syllables, Lord Vishnu will steal away from you. Everybody gets frightened. Oh no, what did I just do? He will steal away from you all your misfortune, all your suffering, all your sins. Then open it. Take it. Steal it away. If someone will come in your house and steal all your garbage, you don't care. That's okay. So like that. There's so many nice verses. So we have to learn to preach. I find it's like every new place is a little different. I preach in India, and Indian expats places. They have their different orientations. And how to actually bring them at least to become favorable to Vishnu worship and Krishna worship, and how to see things from the right perspective. So this is, when people come to Mayapur, this is Bhakti Loka. Even when they go on Navadvip Parikram, Lord Chaitanya told Shankaracharya, don't preach in Navadvip. You go preach other places, not here. This is my Bhakti place. So now I don't want any Mayavadi preaching here. So he sent him out at Shankarpur. He met Shankaracharya and told him, okay, you have your Klinga Seva to me, it's incarnation of Shiva, but not in Mahadi. This is my place for Bhakti. So we can bring people to Mayapur. We have some nice program for them. We can bring them to the path of Bhakti very easily. Because here there's so much mercy from Lord Chaitanya Panchatattva Radha Madhava Mayapur Chandra. How many of you feel by coming to Mayapur your bhakti has increased? Wow! Mayapur bhakti! Goranga! Maybe if Mayapur had been manifested at that time, even there was hope for Dhritarashtra. Maybe he took part in the Chaitanya Leela. Anyway, we see in the Bhagavatam holy places and pure devotees, they are very much glorifying. Somehow or another, we want people to get back to Godhead. So thank you all for coming here to Mayapur Dham, helping us to. Just by being here, that's also helping to spread the message. Would somebody like to help to develop this pilgrimage preaching program? This is one of the services that Mayapur can give shelter to so many people in the future. While we're developing Mayapur, that was one of the missions. Actually, when Prabhupada was here, there were just many foreigners coming here. There weren't so many Indians. The Indians were going to Chaitanya. And Prabhupada was saying, why is people aren't coming here? But now it's only people are coming. But mostly the Indians are coming. When Indians are coming, sometimes one foreigner came at the land of Calcutta airport. And then all the taxi drivers said, Mayapur, most of the foreigners come to Calcutta. They go to Mayapur. So they said, okay, why not? Mayapur. Got it. And the taxi came out, it didn't know anything, you know. I said, I don't know, they call me Mayapur. I thought, what is Mayapur? I'll find out. So, we need to put us on some tourist map, but it's not very much promoting it. It's a good scope, especially here in the winter, it's very nice. The other places, it's too cold. Hadra Rishikesh in winter, this is a good place. That's 0 degrees, 1 degree there. So you bring all the tourists here for the winter month. Anyway, thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Any questions? Comments? Hi, Valya. What if somebody's off?
What if someone's maybe a little critical or offensive and dealing with devotees, but they take offense at someone that's quite innocent and, you know, quite sincere? So how does Krishna do that?
Depends who's offended. The person offended is a devotee. Then it's something that they have to resolve. The person offended is not in the body. They're offended, but for no good reason, then Krishna would see the reason whether there was really something offensive that happened. In general, of course, we don't want anyone to feel offended. So we try to patch any kind of wounds, any misunderstandings in some way.
But if you have tried all those things, but the party still insists on, no way, I'm not, if they're just taking that.
You can always steal some dust from their shoes and touch their feet or something. Then you're absolved. Even if they don't do it themselves.
I have a question about Vidura and Dhritarashtra's relationship, because Vidura was Dhritarashtra's junior in terms of years and position, and he was spiritually more advanced than Dhritarashtra. So in his preaching to Dhritarashtra, my question is, was he preaching from the platform of equanimity, he was preaching from the platform of sadhu, or was it that he was somewhat moved by his affection for his older brother?
Both are mentioned, just like it says in this verse, that he had some sentiment for his brother. At the same time, he was, he had a relationship, he could utilize that for preaching. It's also interesting because sometimes we just reject all our family relationships. But here, Vidura showed that because he had a relationship, there weren't many people in the world who could talk to Dhritarashtra. Mm-hmm. And certainly nobody could speak to him and give him the sauce like Vidura did. He was the only one that could do that because he was the brother. Brothers can get away with stuff like that. Because he's the king's father and Maharaj and all that. If anybody else tried to give him the sauce, I'm sure his false ego would have gone in the way. But Vidura knew how to play on his false ego in an appropriate way. Because of his relationship, he would get away with it. like that, sometimes we may have a brother, or we may have a mother, we have some relation. We can use that. It's from their point of view. Maybe the body is, in one sense, detached from all those relationships. And not so much involved in them. May not be a very deep thing. I'm sure that whatever sentiment that Vidura had for Dhritarashtra, it was not the overriding thing in his life. Didn't overrun everything, but there was some sentiment there where humans were people that have sentiment. So he was happy to see that Dhritarashtra, he also as a devotee, the sentiment is only preaching to his brother. Somehow in Kali Yuga we have this great opportunity to preach to everybody. Preaching is very much the process recommended, the Sankirtan Yajna. When other yugas, going out and preaching was not so much the process. People would go to some sadhu and some holy place, make some inquiry, learn something. That was where the you searched out the sadhu. You go to pilgrimage, and in the pilgrimage place you find out some holy person and you ask him some questions. That was more the process. Now the sadhus are going door to door with Bhaktivinoda books, Bhagavad Gita's, Srimad Bhagavatam sense. So the sadhus are bringing the message to you. That's the mercy of Kali Yuga's Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's Sankirtan movement. But still, if someone comes to Mayapur, Prabhupada mentioned that when we go out preaching, he gave an interesting example. In India, you have got different kinds of shops. Some shops, they have a big sign and it says fixed price or one price. Means you cannot bargain. Whatever price they wrote, that price you have to pay. So like most of the sweet shops, they are fixed price. You want to go and buy sweet misti dahi or sandesh or rasgulla or burpee or rabri or something, it's all one fixed price. Of course, unless you buy some huge quantity, then maybe you can. But this is where the retail sales is all fixed price. But they have also, like there's a guy that came yesterday to the Jagannath Mandir with yogurt. He was selling misti dahi. And he was carrying on his back two baskets. So Prabhupada said, the people that go door to door, who go door to door, you can bargain with them. I mean, they're bringing it on their back, you know, so they may say 30 rupees for a liter of misti dahi. You may bargain with them, no, I'll only give you 25. Or 20, and you fix up at 25. The Prabhupada said, when we go out preaching, sometimes we have to be more discreet because we are going to sell the goods outside. We're going on their terms. When they come to Mayapur, we can have fixed price. So when they come here, like Prabhupada, one time he was at the end of the arti. When we all do Jaya, Vishnupa, everybody starts bowing down. There was one Bengali gentleman standing there. And Prabhupada ordered him, bow down! Bow down! Bow down, mister! Anyway, say bow down! You're Prabhupada. You come in this temple, you bow down. He was listening, and here we can present it as it is. Krishna Supreme Personality of Godhead. Sarvadharmam Vrijaja Bhave Kam Saranamrita Surrender to Krishna. We get away with that here. It's our place. There was some group team here, they were chanting Ram Narayan Ram, and some bogus guy came to me, avatar. So I told them, no, only Hare Krishna. No, it's all no, only Hare Krishna. finally they couldn't stop and threw them out. But they followed that principle. Because here, that principle, Hare Krishna Mahamantra, no other, you speculated from here. But if they're chanting in the street and we're down, we can't stop. Madhai Prabhu is raising his right hand.
The Dhritarashtra committed so many offenses. And without getting relief from the offense, no one can go to spiritual planet. That's how Dhritarashtra had a chance to go to the austerity and come back with
the even the demons get Saujamukti. Even the demons, when they're killed by Krishna, they get the merging mukti. Even though he was a pencil, he could get impersonal liberation. So by yoga you can get impersonal liberation, also you can get the realization of Paramatma. Or you can go to some heavenly planet. So somehow he went some perfection. Whether he went to Swarga or he went to the impersonal Brahmajyoti. Prabhupada indicates it doesn't mean he went to the spiritual
center.
But that's the scope for the offensive people, the Mayavadis, the demon, they can also get impersonal liberation. The Krishna is also giving them some chance to get out of the material world. But it's not the full liberation, it's a partial liberation. So by Vidura's blessing, you at least get out of the suffering of the material world. The problem is in the end to come back again. Many times before you can become a devotee. So they're definitely very pure of him. Otherwise he was headed to hell, so he definitely got a much better thing. Okay? One last question here.
I'm just for the interest of what you are doing. You were mentioning in your class about promoting Mayapur as a tourism center.
Pilgrimage.
So, in fact, His Holiness Maharaj has just, Dr. Prashada Maharaj has just instructed me, and we are in touch with the Union Tourism Minister, who has accepted the invitation to be as one of the chief guests of next year's World Tour.
Chai!
We're celebrating 40 years of next year.
Thank you for watching our videos. Be sure to subscribe to our channel. We publish new videos every day, and don't forget to like and share our channel.